Recorded Books and One Click Digital present Star Road by Matthew Costello and Rick Hautala. Narrated by Pete Bradbury.
Prologue. The Road to Hell. Chapter 1. The Thalos Mining Company. Captain Marie Rieu stood by a railing overlooking the massive hold of the mining ship Seropian. The cargo ship had been designed to do one thing and one thing only, to carry the rare ores found on distant, desolate planets back to an ever-hungry Earth and its colonies. Rieu watched as one of the mine's ore ferries landed and dumped its supply of ore. Another small ferry ship floated outside, waiting to enter the airlock system, and still more were waiting below, on planet, loaded, and ready to link up with the cargo ship in geosynchronous orbit. All day long, though who the hell remembered how long a day was here, the mining ships traveled from planet to cargo ship and back to planet. Rieu had to wonder if this was what she had trained for all these years. The excitement of space travel? Certainly not here, sitting in the middle of nowhere, waiting until the cargo ship's giant belly grew full, and then making the trip to the way station, to the Star Road, and finally home. Well, not home. A smelting plant on the Lunar Base 14. But close enough to home to count. Over and over, this routine made her romantic notions about being a space captain seem absurd. I'm a damn truck driver, she thought. The tedium was matched by a constant urge to get the hell away from here, back to where there were green growing things in the normal days and nights of Earth. The small ore ferry below had finished dumping its load and started its return trip to the surface of Thalos. Moving along. Good. All Rieu could think was hurry. Fill me up so I could leave this godforsaken place. Because if there ever was a place the god had forsaken, it was the dismal planet below. Sam Hatch looked up as another ferry moved away from the ore processors, engines blasting as it passed over the great grinding conveyors that brought the ore to the ferries. Each ferry carried tons of ore up to the cargo ship that circled like a hungry bird of prey above the small, red-stained planet called Thalos. The Seropian was up there, he knew. But damned if he could see the ship, or even the stars, through the clouds of red dust churned up by the mining operations. When that cargo ship was full, it would leave to be replaced with another. And another. He looked at the open wound of the mine itself. Huge trucks crawled back and forth over the rubble. The giant diggers, like ancient lumbering dinosaurs, endlessly moving into caves and then down below the surface, back to the deep shafts where teams of miners armed with explosives and tools hunted for new veins of minerals. Non-stop. The mining operation was an endless machine. So far, this planet, whose home star wasn't even visible from Earth, appeared to be rich with the rare ores and heavy metals that could be used to make everything from the World Council's computers to the good citizens' sex toys. Giant lights covered the area, so there was no visible difference between the broiling days and the frigid nights. And the red dust shot constantly into the air as if the planet itself were wounded, a bleeding cloud created by the miners' endless digging. Hatch was satisfied. All was running smoothly. Unlike the miners, whose contracts were tied to how long they worked, his depended on meeting his weekly quota. The faster he got the ore, the sooner he would get to leave this hellhole. Then he'd get 6 months of R&R, on a beach somewhere. Palm trees, blue water, drinking, ogling women in and out of bikinis, and forgetting about this ugly rock, the grinding noises, the dull-eyed miners, and the constant pressure to transport more and more ore. Everyone appeared to be working as fast as they could. The machine's mindless efficiency seemed matched by that of the men. All of them, men and machines, covered with the red stain of the planet. But could he really tell? Are the loads full? Do the workers stop to bullshit, eating up precious minutes? The whole operation of filling the cargo ship just couldn't go damn fast enough for Hatch. He turned away and walked over to the miners' camp to have a few shots. and maybe see if any of the miners decided to go buggy tonight. Because some did go buggy. For some, it wasn't a question of if, but when. Hatch took the shot glass and downed the dark rum in a gulp. The woman behind the bar hadn't been picked for her beauty, but he supposed that a patron with enough booze would hit on her, drunk and wearing thick enough beer goggles to make him see double. Right. Look, she has a twin sister. Before that patron keeled over and had to be hauled back to the miners' quarters and tossed into a narrow cot, where the noise of the miners snoring was like a rocket engine's roar. Another, Hatch said, slamming his empty shot glass out of the counter. Don't dent the wood, the bartender said as she refilled him. And as he took the second drink, Hatch looked around the bar. Nice and quiet. Off-duty miners sitting at tables, talking about the day, making jokes. This drill bit broke. That grinder shattered. This guy fucked up planting the explosives and almost blew his team to hell. Others indulged in the biggest sin of all. Talking about home. Earth. Holidays. Kids. Wives. Food. Sex. Now that kind of talk would definitely turn you buggy, Hatch thought. Though it was in his mind 24/7, too. Even here, on this planet with its 56-hour rotation, everyone operated on standard Earth time and thought about their home planet constantly. Good thing the operation here was outfitted with an infirmary stocked with enough Class A drugs to sedate a city. No one could run this job without that safety net, even though the booze was usually enough to keep things in check. He liked having a belt or two, and then standing there with his handguns at his side, wearing his weapons like some goddamn sheriff. It had worked in Dodge and Tucson in the 1800s. Maybe it would work here. The only other guns were in the hands of the security guards who were posted at key spots with pulse weapons. You certainly wouldn't want any of these miners running around with guns. The barroom door opened, and Parker, his assistant who watched the tonnage, who really knew how much ore was being moved, came in. He scanned the room for Hatch, caught his eye, and then hurried over. Before he could speak, Hatch did. Parker, I'm off duty. Whatever the hell it is, we got a jam up on the ship, Mr. Hatch. Parker's eyes looked frantic. Last ferry got engine trouble. Shit, Hatch said. That would lead to a line of ferries burning fuel, waiting to get into the Seropian's hold. Eating time, screwing the day's quota, making me fucking lose money. Great. Terrific. What are they? Captain Ryu has her team working on it. Shouldn't be too long, but you said... I know what I said. I want to know about any delays. Before Parker could reply, Hatch turned away and nodded at the bartender, a tilt of the head signaling he wanted another hit. A quick pour from the bartender, and he tossed the rum down, letting it burn his tongue and throat. You did your duty, now get back to it. It took Parker a few seconds to realize that he was being told to go. And Hatch went back to what he thought would be his last drink of the day before crawling back to his private quarters to shower and sleep, and dream about any damn place other than here. Ryu paced the bridge of the Seropian. The dead ore ferry still blocked the entryway for the line of others waiting outside. How long was this holdup going to be? She had a good engineering team. They'd find the problem and get things moving again. But it would take time. She could imagine that down below, Hatch wasn't pleased at all. Well, too bad, she thought. She looked at the bridge crew, all young, raw, inexperienced. Most of them were only on their second or third tour, still excited at being in deep space. The reality of what this really was hadn't sunk in yet. The utter boredom. She checked the time and decided her workday was over. The ore ship would be repaired, eventually. Nothing much to do. Watching and pacing the bridge wasn't going to make them work any faster. But then, something held her there. Maybe just the need for one last look before she left for the night. The sounds of the bridge, the beeps and pings mixed with bursts of static from solar flares of the system star, all turned into meaningless background chatter. One monitor displayed the immobile ferry blocking the cargo bay, while others showed the red planet below, the stars outside in strange constellations, and the distant shimmering strand of the star road. Other screens filled with endless streams of ship's data, heating, cooling, oxygen, and gravity levels. All good, all okay. Might as well turn in, she thought. Fahir, her communications officer, suddenly spoke up, breaking the silence. Captain, I'm picking up something. Ryu wheeled around to face him. Something, Lieutenant? Signals coming in. Can't see how many yet. They're masking their ID. Masking? I'm trying to raise them, but they're not responding. Ryu turned to the navigation station. Miller, a woman half Ryu's age, looked up, her inexperience reflected in her eyes. Miller, can you plot their course? The navigation officer nodded, already working on it. Got it, Captain, she said. They're vectoring right toward us, five vessels. Then Fahir turned to her and said the one word that crystallized everyone's biggest fear these days. Runners? Can't be, Ryu thought. Not this far in system. Not when their goddamn leader is on trial on Earth. The runners are finished, that's what people say. Runners aren't going to raid a mining operation, Ryu said. She tried to project calm even though she didn't know what the hell was going on. With that ore ship crippled in the bay, they were an easy target. Nearest road portal is how far? 4 AUs away, Captain, Miller said. Ryu shook her head. Why the hell would anyone come this far in system? They can't be runners. But that forced the question. Then who are they? One monitor tracked the five ships coming in quickly, heading toward the Seropian. Until, close enough, the first images appeared on screen. Ryu moved closer to the monitor and saw a gunship and four smaller raider escorts. She thought, why all that goddamn firepower heading here? And then, they can only be runners. Ryu turned to face the crew on the bridge. From this point on, everyone would hear her voice loud and clear. She hit a button on the security display, and the quiet of the bridge was shattered by the blaring of a klaxon. Emergency lights flashed on scores of consoles. Battle stations, she said. All hands to battle stations. Prepare for... She shook her head. Battle stations? Stalled in space with the open cargo hold, the ship was unable to take defensive maneuvers. All that was left was for the Seropian to take the first hit, while everyone waited to feel the shattering vibrations of that first blast. Chapter 2. The Runners. Like everyone else in the bar, Hatch saw the brilliant flash of the explosions outside. His first thought, something's gone wrong in one of the mine shafts. A goddamn explosion. Another screw-up that would set the timetable back days, if not weeks. Miners scrambled to the windows of the bar and looked out. Several ran outside. Hatch saw them pointing to the sky, but he still could see nothing through the haze of red dust. His mind raced, trying to figure out what the hell had just happened. He pushed his way past them and went outside. A quick look at the mine operation. Miners had stopped and now stared up at the sky, waiting for more lights, more flashes. Then, through the haze above, he could barely discern the massive cargo ship. It appeared to be shit, exploding. And all around it, were those fragments of the cargo ships or smaller vessels burning up on re-entry? His earpiece started to vibrate. He fished it from his pocket and stuck it into his ear. What is it? Something's wrong with the cargo ship, sir. It was Parker. They've gone to... But another, even bigger flash cut off Parker's words. Unnecessary words, since Hatch could look up. Even through the red haze, he could watch it all and think, we are so fucked. Ryu started firing off orders, following protocol for the endlessly drilled response to a major attack. Everything moved with a surreal franticness. She was still trying to believe this was really happening. Ready emergency evac stations. Power up the pulse cannons. All stations, fire at will. Execute evasive maneuvers. Commands flew from her, and her officers shouted into microphones, hit buttons, looked at computer screens and data readouts. In the panic, their faces masks of inexperience and fear. The screens told the whole story. Those monitoring conditions outside the ship showed the runners' ships buzzing around like gnats, firing at the Seropian mercilessly. As they fired, a rapid series of explosions made the giant ship shudder and rock with a slow, lumbering roll. Are we even firing back? Ryu wondered. Were any of those goddamn explosions from any of the Seropians' pulse cannons? They were good weapons, powerful and accurate. But against this onslaught, with this inexperienced crew? Then she had the next unforgivable thought. I have to surrender. Now, while most of our systems are still running, while we're still mostly alive. Fahir, see if you can raise them. But Ryu knew that the ships outside had ignored all attempts at communication. Why would they talk now? They were minutes away from having the cargo ship dead in orbit. Its ore, theirs for the taking. And down below, what would they do on the planet? Captain, they still won't respond. Keep trying. Another blast. The ship now bobbing in its low orbit like a cork in a raging river. Keep try. She never finished the sentence. The next blast didn't echo from thousands of meters away from some distant part of the ship. This blast targeted the bridge itself. Walls of electronics and computers that girdled the main deck exploded inward. Ryu was in the center as shattered plastic and twisted pieces of metal flew around her and into her, slicing deep into her skin. For a few seconds, she was still able to remain standing in the chaos despite the battering. But then a second blast hit the bridge, and although she didn't see it, Ryu felt something ram right into her, a piece of metal, a structural section from the room blown free and turned into a spear. She had a moment's awareness of being hit, and then she dropped to her knees and pitched forward. Parker, Hatch said into his radio mouthpiece, did you get the data pod sent out? Yeah, but it... The radio went dead in Hatch's ear. At least the World Council would get the news in a few minutes of video of whatever the hell was happening. A runner's raid. Who would believe it without film? They were supposedly over, finished. But they didn't look too finished now. Hopefully the runners wouldn't intercept the message pod before it got to the Star Road. Once there, its mass was so small it would travel much too fast on the road for anyone to intercept. Hatch pulled out his revolver. Old school. Antiques. Real treasures. The runners above had peeled away from the cargo ship, which was now sending off a steady stream of fiery, soundless explosions. Flaming chunks of metal flared, a fireworks display as they entered the atmosphere. Hatch didn't want to think about how this attack was going to negate his chances of leaving soon. Guess we're all going to be down here for a while longer. Then it hit him. What an absurd thought. We'll all be goddamn lucky to live much longer. He looked at the miners, panicking, helpless as they realized what was happening in the sky above. Some scrambled for cover, others stood out in the open, as if it mattered. Everyone knew how brutal runners were. But why attack here? And what would they do once they got here? The miners had to be thinking about the possibilities of defending themselves and their chances of surviving an attack.
Some miners might hide deep in the winding corridors of the mines, especially if they were suited up in their mining rigs. There were caches of emergency rations placed throughout the mine system. Maybe the runners wouldn't take the time to hunt them down. The runners might blow up the mine entrances, trapping them underground to die unless they could eventually dig their way out once the runners left. They wouldn't stick around long. Anyone on the surface would probably be lucky if the pirates took them as prisoners, forced them to join the runners. But the most realistic possibility was that they'd all be killed. The miners' security force, a half dozen men armed with pulse rifles, had their guns down, looking up and around, waiting. They didn't have to wait long. The roar of runner vehicles screaming over the rubble surrounding the mine area filled the night air. Hatch watched the ATV bounce over the rocky terrain and fly over the pits in the ground with ease, their oversized composite tires handling the torturous terrain. Each ATV had a gunner firing a small pulse cannon mounted on the front. Hatch looked around. The vehicles converged on the mining site from every compass point. The runners started shooting, mowing the miners down. The security guards started firing back while others began running, looking for an illusory safe place. Hatch soon understood what was going on here. A massacre. And maybe a message. He drew his handguns and started firing. They'd always been more for show than anything else, to let everyone know he wasn't only the project manager. He ran this place. Did the guns have enough range to hit the runners' ATVs? Was his aim any good? He fired at an approaching ATV, taking aim at the driver. A hole bloomed in his head, and the runner slumped down in his seat, the ATV careening to the side. It went up in an orange ball of flames. Hatch wheeled around to see another approaching vehicle. He took aim and fired again. The first shot went wide. Deep down inside, he knew this whole effort was wasted, useless. There were too many of them, until two ATVs converged behind Hatch. He spun around and dropped to a crouch, firing both guns as he did. The two gunners fired back at him at the same time. No way they'd miss him. And then, Hatch's last thought again. Why? Chapter 3. Release. The doors to the World Council Court flew open. Outside, total chaos. Ivan Delgado, flanked by guards, with double-lock handcuffs holding his wrists together and leg cuffs around his ankles, knees, and thighs that made it all but impossible for him to walk, took in the scene. Everyone here, all to see me, he thought. Reporters filled the granite steps of the World Council Court, leading down to a waiting line of armored vans. Behind the wall of cameras, curious onlookers jockeyed for a good view. The trial of the decade, his trial, was over. Delgado knew he didn't stand a chance, not when he'd admitted to being the leader of the runners. Loud cheers and catcalls battled as the guards held his arms, standing between two massive stone pillars of the court building. Got my fans, Delgado thought. He looked behind him. More heavily armed security guards and police poured out from the building to either side of Delgado. A goddamn army. What the hell do they think I'm gonna do? The crowd kept up its yelling. He looked at some of the signs they carried, the scrawled messages. Free Delgado. Open the roads. Off to one side, a few steps down, a young, attractive reporter faced the holocam, reading from a prompter. She barely glanced at the main attraction as she read her live report. In Washington today, the World Council Court handed down a sentence of guilty on all counts in the treason case against Ivan Delgado, the leader of the terrorist faction known as the Roadrunners. A few meters away from her, another reporter doing the same thing. Yeah, I'll be all over the vids tonight, The reporter looked at Delgado, even seemed to raise his voice so he could hear.
Ivan Delgado has been sentenced to life without the possibility of parole at the Cyrus Penal Colony in the Movasi sector. This may be the last you will see of the leader of the Roadrunners.
His guards let him stay on display for the cameras and the crowd, speaking into their headsets, nodding.
Cyrus Penal Colony. Now doesn't that sound like fun?
The guards began guiding him slowly down the steps. Reporters tried to thrust microphones into his face.
Do you plan to appeal? Who leads the runners now that you're gone?
But the other security guards fanned out to either side, pushing the reporters back. They didn't want any roadrunners making speeches. The cheers and jeers rose in volume. Delgado looked up. The clear blue sky, the sun already hot. Beads of sweat formed on his brow. He might have been strolling on a beach in the Caribbean. Wouldn't that be nice?
Free the road! Free the road!
A large group off to one side began to chant. Before long, others joined in, and then they were quickly countered by another chant.
Death to terrorists!
Can't please everyone.
Then, a marble pillar less than 6 inches from Delgado's head exploded. Chips of stone and stone dust flew into the air. The report of a gunshot echoed from the giant stone walls of the courthouse. The police escorts raised their shields and tightened the line around Delgado. He watched several security officers below wrestling a man to the ground. If the guy had been a better shot, this show would have had a completely different ending. The police hurried the guy away, the shooter's feet kicking at the air as they moved him down to the street to one of the waiting armored vans. They expected trouble, and they got it. Questions continued to fly as Delgado's guards led him down, pushing through the sea of reporters, his steps small, constricted by the cuffs. Once at the van, the side door slid open and his guards lifted him off the ground and threw him into the back. Before the van door slammed shut, one of the policemen remaining on the street turned and spit into Delgado's face.
Pretty brave, Delgado thought. But without cuffs? Now, officer, wouldn't that be interesting? He smiled and wiped his cheek on the shoulder of his prison jumpsuit. They don't know, he thought. The secret that no one, not here at least, knows about. The shooter wasn't the only surprise today, not by a long shot. Still, as the van pulled away from the curb, Delgado felt isolated, as alone as he had ever been. Whatever his life had been up until now, today it had been altered fundamentally and forever. There was no going back, even if he wanted to. The van started, and Delgado felt it quickly pull away, the sirens of the escorts wailing as the caravan left the courthouse. Part 1. Fellow Travelers. Chapter 4. Star Road Access Terminal, Pluto. Dr. Dario Rodriguez tried to take it all in and understand what he was seeing as the small transport shuttle skimmed over the surface of the planet. His first thought, no matter how many times you see it, it's always impressive. Whatever the thing was down below, it was massive. A giant abstract art construction made by a lunatic, consisting of jumbled chunks of red and gray stone and steel girders jutting out at random angles. The sky was as black as ebony. The planet had no atmosphere to diffuse the light from the infinite array of stars. Earth's sun was just a white pinprick of light against the eternal void of space. Outside, on what long ago had been known as the planet Pluto, but was now an insignificant planetoid, there remained the ruins. Vast remnants of a past civilization whose beings used to live here, or come here, for what? Had been left on this dead planet out on the frozen rim of Earth's solar system. But that had been eons ago, for all anyone knew. Then something happened, and they vanished, leaving behind only these ruins and questions.
and the Star Road station.
The transport banked hard to the left as if trying to impress the passengers, giving them a different perspective on what may have been an ancient city. Bright lights dotted the shadowed work areas of the site as teams, all carefully controlled by the World Council, carried out methodical excavations to determine the origin and purpose of this place. People on Earth knew nearly nothing about it except that it existed, and that it may have been destroyed well before the dinosaurs were extinct. Yet the Star Road had been untouched. Is that because whoever or whatever had caused the destruction below depended on the Star Road as well? Or perhaps the Star Road was invulnerable? So far, it had defied Earth's best physicists. All anyone really knew was that the road was still here, and it linked humanity to the stars. So many questions, and Rodriguez knew that a lot of people were busy here and on Earth searching for those answers. There were almost as many answers as there were questioners. Whatever the case, the road worked, and humanity used it. With the Star Road, Earth and its solar system suddenly seemed much too small, a coral reef in an infinite ocean of stars. Travel through the galaxy, theoretically an impossibility, suddenly became possible. Systems hundreds, even thousands of light years apart could be easily accessed by traveling on the Star Road. An amazingly complicated highway system had opened up, and no one knew how far it went, where it ended, if it ended, or the big question, who the hell had created it. People on Earth referred to them simply as the Builders, but that answered nothing. The transport banked again, straightening out as it lost altitude, following the sharp curve of the tiny planet. The horizon looked impossibly close. Rodriguez took a moment and glanced around at the shadowy confines of the shuttle, at the dark figures of the dozen or so other passengers. Are they all getting onto the road? Or are some cycling back for another stint on the terminal base on Pluto? Most sat quietly in their seats, some dozing, some lost in their own thoughts as they gazed at the amazing scene outside. Everyone, except for the young woman sitting across the aisle from Rodriguez. In the scant light, he caught her fiddling with the chip recorder implanted in the side of her head above her left ear. As the woman literally squirmed in her seat, her head moving all around the oval portal, Rodriguez knew that the woman, almost a kid really, was more than a chippy, more than a user. She was in record mode, creating a new chip even now, capturing this moment for others on Earth to experience as if they were here. All the experience, none of the risk, none of the stress, none of the expense or danger. None of the excitement, either. If this chippy wanted to make an amazing chip, she probably couldn't do better than a road trip. Unless she went in for the kinky stuff. Scanning her face, her body, Rodriguez imagined that she just might. She turned and caught Rodriguez staring at her. A bit of a smile, then a taunt. Some view, hmm? Rodriguez nodded, still staring. See anything you like? Sure, Rodriguez replied. Then he turned away. No doubt he wasn't the only one in the shuttle who had secrets. Everyone has their secrets. But he was getting on the road for a reason that no one, especially not a chippy, could know about. On that point, his instructions were clear. And Rodriguez was nothing if not good at following instructions. He turned back to his porthole and stared blankly as the shuttle approached the terminal. The shuttle glided silently over the icy rocks that looked like the aged teeth of a mouth frozen in the act of arcing up the snap at the shuttle. Ahead, a bright glow. The transport base. Mobius Central. Named, Rodriguez guessed, because the first scientists who'd found it couldn't figure out how the hell the Star Road, seemingly an actual structure, could somehow stretch its spidery strands throughout the galaxy and maybe beyond. Totally impossible. It beat all quantum physics into a pulp. What was it made of? What powered it? All unknown. Even after over a decade of using the road, humans had unraveled only a small part of the mystery of this impossible structure. Impossible. Just like a Mobius strip. The process of building a road map was slow, a lot of trial and error. Especially error, at first. A lot of vessels and good men and women gone and never heard from again. A detailed map of the system could change everything. But so far, at least, no such map existed. Would Rodriguez's mission yield some answers? He didn't have a clue. The dome ahead started to fill the porthole view. A giant bubble of light revealing the people and areas inside. On one side, a row of airlocks. On the other, terminals to access the road. A small beep sounded from the speaker above Rodriguez, and the holovoid winked on, displaying the smiling face of a shuttle hostess. Then, "Attention, travelers. Our shuttle is about to dock at the Mobius Central Airlock. Please check to make sure your seat harness is firmly buckled and that you have no loose articles near you. We will be touching down on the surface of Pluto in 5 minutes." Rodriguez checked that the harness, a belt, and a pair of cross shoulder straps were tight. Then a voice. The girl. The chippy. "That's funny." Rodriguez turned to her, seeing more clearly now. Short dark hair and blue-green eyes that glowed cat-like in the pale light. "What is?" "Why'd they name the planet after a dog? Not even a real dog." And despite what lay ahead, the responsibility, the unknown, the sheer adventure of it, Rodriguez laughed. He decided not to tell her that Pluto was also the Roman god of the underworld. The shuttle began its easy glide as it made its way into the airlock chamber. Annie Scott watched the load lifter raise a massive metal crate and lower it into the SRV's cargo hold. At first, it looked like the crate couldn't possibly fit. And then, as if to force it, the operator bumped the crate into the undercarriage of the Star Road vehicle.
"Whoa, bloody hell!" a man standing close to Annie yelled. "Take it the fuck easy! Jesus, who's in charge here?"
His accent was a thick Scottish brogue. Annie saw the operator look down at the man, maybe measuring him for a fight if it came to that. Then he looked to Annie, who raised her eyebrows a bit. The operator stopped the machinery.
"You got a bunch of monkeys working this thing? God damn!"
Then louder, directly at the motionless operator.
"Where's your captain, genius?"
Annie took a few steps closer to the man. "That would be me." The man turned to her, his face registering, what? Disbelief? Confusion? Embarrassment. As if he thought the road was for men only. In other words, total bullshit. "Captain Annie Scott." She extended her hand for him to shake. The man rubbed his chin, momentarily stumped, then shook hands with her. His calloused hand felt like a slab of overcooked beef. "That your load, Mr.?"
"McGowan, and it sure the hell is. My mining suit. You have any idea how much one of them things costs?"
"Actually, I do." Annie knew that the far-flung mining operations relied on these kinds of freelancers, guys with the expensive suits built to their personal specifications, a necessary entryway into a lucrative, if often deadly, business of off-world mining. Sure, miners made a lot of money, but most of them never came back, and if they did, they were never satisfied and they went out again. Things happened once you burrowed into an unknown planet, which certainly explained the guy's jumpiness. "Those suits," Annie said, nodding at the frozen load operator. "They're built to resist a lot of stress, right? Cave-ins, meteorites and such."
"Yeah, so?"
"You think," and here she leaned closer as if the two of them were sharing a secret, "a little bump from my ground guy here trying to edge it into the cargo hold could hurt it even a wee bit?" The man's face remained set, then a bit of a smile. He certainly looked seasoned to Annie's expert eye, but who knew? Something was bugging him. Maybe he was prone to road sickness. You'd have to keep an eye on him.
I guess not.
Then a genuine smile.
So how about I get him to finish getting your suit on board and you can go to the bar and grab a cold one before we head out?
Sounds like a plan.
Then after a pause.
Captain?
Another smile and McGowan headed for the bar, the not-so-creatively named Star Lounge. Annie looked up at the load operator.
Okay, Jackie, let's get her in. The clock is ticking.
The operator began to ease the crate inside the hold, this time getting the angle right so the crate slid into the open underbelly of the SRV. Crisis averted, Annie thought. And then, as if that would be the only problem she'd have to deal with before they took off, a trio of high-pitched chirps signaled that she had a message. She touched her earpiece and turned away from the SRV.
Captain Scott.
Annie, I got something you better see.
Humphreys, the terminal director.
Nothing came into or left Mobius without his approval.
His voice sounded tight. No banter.
Come up to the office, he barked.
I'm in the middle of...
Now.
Annie looked back at the load operator, who was now picking up smaller containers and loading them. He had a good 20-30 minutes more work before they could start boarding passengers. Close to another hour standard Earth time before they could leave. Be right there. And she started hurrying through the open expanse of the terminal to the elevators that led up to the skybox, the director's office.
Get you something, pal?
From the bartender's demeanor, Rodriguez could have been in his favorite dive bar on 9th and 46th. Pretty damn far away from that.
Sure, what do you have that's cold?
The bartender gestured at a tap.
Got a fresh barrel of ER Dark on tap.
Sounds good.
Brewed right here.
Rodriguez looked up to see if the guy was putting him on. Not a hint of a smile.
No shit.
So fresh it'll slap your face.
He convinced me. The bartender turned away to grab a Pilsner glass, and suddenly the seat beside Rodriguez was taken. I'm traveling with a lot of chips in case, you know, if you get bored. He turned to see that he now had a new best friend and travel companion, the Chippy. I'll remember that, he said casually, not wanting his need to show. She stuck out a hand with long, slender fingers. Sanjira Renku, she said. Is that one name or two? Ignoring his question. Looks like we're maybe on the same SRV. He took her extended hand and gave it a quick shake. The grip was warm, firm. Looks that way, he said, wishing the bartender would hurry up with that beer. What are you doing, business, vacation?
What's that? Rodriguez said. Then he grinned.
Work? What you do? I'm a scientist. I do science things. The girl made a silent O with her mouth, but Rodriguez wasn't sure if she'd caught his sarcasm or not. With chippies, you never knew. When the bartender slid the beer in front of him, with an actual frothy head, she said quickly,
Oh, yum. Me too.
The bartender turned to get her a beer. Then Sanjira turned and scanned the room, this waiting area for the SRV passengers. Rodriguez knew with a blinking red light on the side of her head that she was recording.
What do you think of her?
Sanjira said, nodding a bit too broadly at the woman sitting at the far table in the corner. A dark cowl shadowed her face, obviously trying not to see or be seen.
Looks like she wants to be left alone.
My guess is she's one of those religious nuts, a seeker,
going on the road to find
what?
And here Sanjira made her two lithe hands explode in a display of fingers shooting out.
The meaning of life?
Could be.
Sanjira's eyes moved on.
How about that one over there? The big guy all by himself. What's his deal?
Beats me. People go on the road for lots of reasons. He may not even be on our SRV.
I hope so. He looks lonely.
She shot Rodriguez a sly smile.
So why doesn't he come over and buy me a drink?
Then,
he looks...
She touched her forefinger to her lower lip, which glistened with a deep red lipstick.
Interesting.
Then she stopped as Rodriguez took a slug of the beer.
Tastes as good as it looks. Whoa, look at him. That guy over there looks damn eager, doesn't he? Might be worth a chip. Edgy, anxious. Some freaks like that stuff.
Go for it. After another deep slug, Rodriguez turned and glanced at the man Sinjira had spotted. He wore a long coat, even though it was a constant 71 degrees in here. Not exactly pacing, but he shuffled back and forth. Stopped, looked around. Every move screamed nervous. Then Rodriguez said,
"Let's hope he's not on our SRV." "Amen, brother," Sinjira said.
The bartender placed a beer in front of her, but she ignored it and went back to studying the workers and passengers who filled the lounge. Annie knocked and then entered the director's office.
"What's up?"
Humphreys stood next to his desk. Beside him was a shorter man. She had obviously interrupted their conversation, although Humphreys had summoned her. The two of them looked at each other as if trying to figure out who was going to speak first. Humphreys began. "Hello, Annie." But that was all.
"Sounded pretty urgent," she replied.
"Well," Humphreys looked at his companion.
"What the hell is it?"
"There's," Humphreys said, "there's been a problem along your route."
"A problem?"
"Near the Omega-9 terminal."
"And?"
"An attack on the mining colony. Could be everyone was slaughtered or captured. It's gone quiet."
"Quiet?"
"No transmissions, nothing at all."
"You think runners?"
"Who else? But nothing's been confirmed." Humphreys took a slow breath. Not even why someone would attack the operation. Nothing of any value there except for the ore, which they could have grabbed off a freighter once it was carrying it back.
"And they have a processing facility where?"
Annie paused.
"They're not that organized. They couldn't run smelters without the World Council catching on."
"Space is a big place and getting bigger by the day."
"So how'd you find out about this attack?"
Another look at the man with him, and then Humphreys tapped the large, flat panel screen behind his desk. It came to life, and after another gesture, a holovid started playing. A face appeared. Eyes wide with fright. Face streaked with sweat. Chewing his lip before he spoke. Was the guy injured, or just totally terrified?
"This is Thalos Station. We've been attacked."
A burst of static scrambled the hologram for a second, and then...
"Wiping us..."
His eyes darted around. Time was obviously of the essence if he's going to get the pod out in time, Annie thought. The last word ended it, though.
"Out."
The image on the screen froze for a count of three and then dissolved into a pixelated mess. Humphreys tapped the screen again, and it went dark.
"When did this come in?"
No answer from either of them.
"This morning? Just now?"
Humphreys lowered his gaze and shook his head. 3 days ago. Annie took a step toward the man who was, on paper at least, her boss. He reeled back as she approached.
"You knew about this and you didn't think to tell me until now?"
"Orders, Captain Scott," said the other man, who hadn't introduced himself, speaking for the first time. "No one is to know about it, other than the council heads, few do." Annie scratched her head.
"Who the hell is this guy?"
"So what now, you expect me to scrub the trip?"
"That's your call, as always. I'm afraid in this matter you can't even consult with your company. You get to know what happened, but for now, that's it. It's classified."
Great. Odds are they made their point with the attack and they moved on.
Odds are,
Annie echoed. She whistled as she exhaled. Probably retaliation for Delgado's trial and conviction, Humphrey said. Annie considered that for a moment. You know I love to gamble, but this, like I said, it's your call. She raised a hand to end the conversation. Not an option, Humphreys. I'm going. I just hate surprises. And now she saw Humphreys glance at the man standing next to him. She knew another surprise was coming. Annie stood there, not saying another word. Let Humphreys bring it up. Okay, you leave in less than an hour. One more thing, though. This is Bill Nahara. Annie still said nothing. She had a feeling she wouldn't like where this was going. He arrived on the shuttle just now. He's going with you. Why? World Council orders, I'm afraid. For what goddamn purpose? You gotta stop at the mining station. Oh, it gets even better, doesn't it? Nahara will carry out an investigation there. Nothing big, just taking a look. Then you're on your way. Annie turned away and walked to the office's wall-sized window that overlooked the terminal. She looked out, staring blankly at the ant-sized people moving around below. Guess I have no say in this after all, huh? Not if you want to leave. Council orders, Nahara said. She didn't like the sound of his voice. Too nasally. You can still say no. But then your clearance will be revoked, Nahara said. Just following orders, Annie, Humphreys added, as if that would help. She stepped closer to the window. The loading was almost done on the SRV. The passengers lingered outside or were in the bar, ready and waiting to board. And then she noticed something. First, just one of the passengers milling about. His movements jerky, odd. Never good to have anyone fidgety on board. Even at their best, road trips were never a smooth ride. Then she looked over at two security guards at the checkpoint where passengers entered the security area once they'd been through the security scan. Both of them had pulse guns slung over their shoulders. She didn't recognize either of the guards. Hang on, who are those? She put a finger up to the glass. Those newbies. Probably just rotated in. Your point? She looked closer at the man below. Now he was circling the passenger area and her instincts kicked in. Something's not right with that guy. And the two newbies aren't paying attention. They might have something to do with it. She turned for the door. Nahara goes, Humphreys called out as she ran past. She didn't stop, but said over her shoulder, We leave in 30 minutes. Be the hell on board or we go without you.
Ignoring the elevator, she couldn't wait that long. She took the staircase down, hitting the steps two at a time. On the ground floor, she pushed the emergency door open and raced to the enclosed area where the passengers were waiting. The two newbies gave Annie a look, scanning her ID tag.
How the hell old are they, she thought. 18? 19? Kids.
Annie slowed her pace when she got close to the other passengers, a few at the bar, most sitting at tables or milling around, guarding their luggage. Going to get to know each other real well soon enough, she thought. But first she was going to get to know the man in the long coat with the twitchy eyes. As she got close, she could almost smell the guy's anxiety. Maybe, she thought, a road trip isn't in the cards for you. She moved to a position so that when the man turned to resume his shuffling steps, he'd be facing her. And when he did...
Sir, she said, extending a hand as if to block him. Hold it right there.
The man looked directly at her.
She fired a quick glance at the two young guards who, so far, had taken no notice. Are you booked for my SRV, sir?
The man's eyes went wide, bug-eyed.
And the guards just let him sail in?
I don't give a damn what kind of clearance this guy has. He deserves a few questions. Like, what planet are you from?
The man hesitated as if she'd asked a trick question. His tongue slipped out between his teeth, looking like he'd swallowed a fat slug that wouldn't go down. Then three jerky nods. Annie forced herself to smile. Great. We'll be loading soon. The SRV is right over there. She indicated it without taking her eyes off him. The man seemed to fight to look away from her. Then he gave the quickest of glances at the waiting Star Road vehicle. Annie kept the smile plastered on her face, but she kept her eyes locked on him, barely blinking. May I see your boarding ship? The man's eyes were glazed now. They didn't move. Annie took another step closer to him. She broadened her smile, thinking, this cork is about to pop. Part of a captain's duty, sir. A last minute. And then it happened. The immobilized man was suddenly fast. The long coat opened and he pulled out a pulse gun, a pistol. In a fraction of a second, the barrel swerved and aimed at what Annie knew had to be a spot right between her eyes. A few people in the area saw what was happening. Someone screamed and then others saw and shouted as they scrambled for cover. Panicked sounds moved like a wave through the terminal. Annie hoped no one did anything stupid. Pulling a gun was stupid enough. If those two newbies raised their weapons now, they could probably take this guy down, but likely only after he burned a hole through Annie's skull. Hey, hold on there, she said. There's no need to...
The road is meant to be free.
One of those guys, Annie thought. A free-the-road zealot. How the hell did he get a boarding chip clearance? He must have paid a ton of credits to someone. And the pulse gun? Maybe someone planted it here for him, past the security. And his plan? Commandeer the SRV? Take out as many people as he could before burning his own brains out? Make a fucking statement with blood? Right. I hear you, sir, but there's no need to... The man's eyes darted back and forth now that he was off plan. What's he going to do? Is he considering getting everyone on the SRV, leaving here, and then what? Kill them or hold them for ransom? Perhaps the idea that he was trapped, that it was already over, was beginning to dawn on him. In which case, what the hell is he going to do? He has an SRV captain at his mercy. A lot of passengers around. Not a bad statement. Bunch of dead bodies. Free the road, indeed. Annie took another step, maintaining steady eye contact with him, not even thinking to look at what might be going on around her, locked in this deadly standoff. Deadly for me, she thought. Why not lower the gun and we can talk? Another small smile, but Annie guessed that her partner in this dance wouldn't opt for that. Annie lowered her gaze to the man's hand, the outstretched arm holding the weapon. Was his grip tightening, or did she only imagine it? Her stomach tightened. She felt like she might throw up. The man licked his lips and then opened his mouth. Free the... His voice wound up higher and then broke. Finger definitely tightening. And then, from the side, an arm flew out of nowhere, hitting the man's outstretched arm and the gun, knocking both to one side. But too late. The trigger pulled. The gun shot a pencil-thin pulse at Annie's head. But the intervention had moved the man's arm just enough. A high-pitched sizzling sound whizzed by, inches from Annie's head. The hairs above her ear actually moved in response to the charged particle burst. Then her savior grabbed the man's gun hand and almost effortlessly twisted it. The gun clattered to the tile floor. Now, finally, the hapless guards were running toward them while the assailant found himself in a firm chokehold, arms pinned to his sides. And finally, Annie realized who her savior was. She walked up to him. Jordan, what the hell? Nice to see you too, Annie. Been a long time, Annie thought. A lot of water under a lot of bridges. Jordan, a gunner. But what was he? Someone upstairs decided you needed me on this trip, Jordan said simply. Luck of the draw, or did you ask to be with me? Jordan smiled and said nothing. Then he indicated the assailant, who was now being collared. One of the guards stretched out a length of yellow-green neoprene and looped it around the man's neck. The collar glowed as the neural interrupters made the man go as limp as a baby. Orders are orders. He smiled, barely. So I'm your gunner, and... They both watched as the security guards dragged the man away. And it looks like once again I've saved your ass. Another tight grin. Annie shook her head. Jordan, damn. Then looking at him. Thanks. My pleasure. Annie smiled at that and then turned to the crowd, all of them watching as if this was some bizarre sporting event. All right, folks, show's over. Time to finish up your drinks and get on board. And then, with Jordan a few steps behind, she strode over to the ramp leading up to the opened hatch of her SRV. It was time to get on the road. When he realized what was going on down in the lobby, Humphreys left his office in a hurry. And Nahara finally saw his chance. Without any hesitation, he walked over to Humphrey's desk and sat down in the plush leather chair. He leaned forward, his face close to the desk, and whispered, "Computer." Something inside the machine clicked, and a thin red laser beam shot out from the screen and scanned his left retina. After a few seconds, the computer's friendly female simulated voice said, "Hello, Bill. Que pasa?" After a nervous look around, Nahara whispered, "Download Matrix 0880. "That's classified information, Bill," the computer voice said. Nahara got up from the desk and went over to the window. Looking out, he saw Humphreys down below talking to the security guards. How long would that take? He didn't have much time. Back at the computer, "I'm authorized to override security clearance with protocol 969 Alpha. After a moment, "Confirmed." Nahara waited, counting seconds. His eyes kept flicking to the door to Humphrey's office. The entire front wall was made of wide panes of glass, 15 meters high. Humphreys would be able to see him as soon as he got to the top of the stairway, if he didn't take the elevator. "Sometime today," Nahara muttered, tapping his fingers on the desktop. "Transfer processing complete in 5, 4, 3. For God's sake, hurry up. 2, 1. Transfer process complete." From the terminal console, a thin transparent crystal with multifaceted sides emerged. It caught and reflected the light in a faint rainbow. Nahara grabbed it, almost ripping it from the slot, and pocketed it. As he glanced up and started moving away from the desk, Humphreys appeared in the doorway. He looked grim, unsmiling. "Well," he said to Nahara, "now that that's settled, you'd best get down there and board your vehicle. It leaves in 10 minutes. When they shook hands, Nahara was keenly aware of how slick with sweat the palm of his hand was. He wondered if Humphreys noticed. He smiled broadly, nodded, and then turned and left. As soon as he was out the door and walking to the elevators, he was filled with a sudden panicked thought. Did I log out of Humphrey's computer? He took a deep breath, held it, and kept walking, forcing himself to keep a slow, easy stride. Fuck it. It's too late to turn back now. Chapter 5. Welcome to the SRV 66. Annie sat down on the, for her, oversized seat and looked at the massive, intimidating control board in front of her. Considering the size of the board, it always amazed her that the SRV actually had something that resembled a steering wheel. That this vehicle could take people across the galaxy, and if you held the wheel and sat back in the pilot seat, you might think you were driving an Italian sports car. Except sports cars didn't come with a panel full of lights, switches, a bank of holoscreens, computer readouts, and a heads-up display. Then another part of that thought. And I actually know how to drive this. Even more amazing.
She liked this moment. Sitting in the chair, ready to run through her pre-journey checklist, minutes away from following Mobius Control's checkout procedure. For these few moments, the SRV was all hers. And then Jordan entered the cockpit, hurrying up the steps from the passenger and baggage area below. He had to bow his head to avoid hitting it against the overhang. "How we looking?" he asked. She turned to him. "Not too shabby." She waited to see if Jordan got it, that hint of innuendo. Jordan was mighty quiet, but also very easy on the eyes. He seemed, though, oblivious, or else willfully ignorant of such things. Innuendo? Not in his vocab. She turned back to the SRV control board and threw some switches, watching the displays change as the ship powered up. A faint hum filled the cockpit.
All good.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.